So today I'm going to be talking about rheumatoid arthritis and how it affects your bones and joints. So let's talk a little bit more about joints. So joints are where bones connect with one another and articulate with each other. So they can be classified based on their structure and function. For structure, there's fibrous, which is made out of fibrous connective tissue. For cartilaginous, they're made out of hyaline cartilage or fibrocartilage. And then for synovial, their distinction is that they have a joint cavity. And then for function, there's synarthrosis, which is immovable. An example of this would be sutures in the skull. There's amphiarthrosis, which is slightly movable. Example of this would be the vertebral disc in the vertebral column. And then there's diarthrosis, which is freely movable joints. Example of this would be the hip joint or the shoulder. So we're going to talk a little bit more about synovial joints because rheumatoid arthritis primarily affects synovial joints. They can affect any joint, but primarily they do affect synovial joints. So bones are joined together by a joint cavity, which is seen over here. This is a joint cavity. And on the ends of the bones, there is articular cartilage, which is made up of a thin layer of hyaline cartilage, of collagen fibers. And then there is the synovial membrane, which produces the synovial fluid. And that provides lubrication between the bones and allows them to move easier. And then it also provides a little bit of cushion, same with the articular cartilage. And then the fibrous membrane is just providing more support for the joint. So what is rheumatoid arthritis? It's an autoimmune disease where the immune system attacks the joints, and this causes chronic inflammation of the joints. It affects both sides of the body. So if you have rheumatoid arthritis in your left wrist, you're going to have it in your right wrist, but it doesn't have to be to the same severity. So you can have a more severe left wrist compared to your right wrist. And then it can also affect other body systems, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. It can affect any joint, but it's most commonly associated with the wrist, the hands, the knees, ankles, and feet. So signs and symptoms, there's joint pain, swelling, stiffness, tenderness, and warmth to the touch of the joint. This is also associated with fatigue, weakness, and then sometimes fever since it is an autoimmune response. It can induce fever. And then over time, the joints can shift and deform, which causes pain because the joints and bones are out of alignment. And then this can lead to damage to other body systems, including the skin, eyes, lung, heart, and blood vessels, because it is inflammation of tissues and organs in the body. So risk factors and prevalence. So according to the CDC, women are 2 to 3 times more likely to have RA, and the highest rate of RA is among people in their 60s. So as you age, RA has an increased risk. And then there's a lot of factors. There's not one factor that contributes to someone having RA. There's genetics or inherited traits, environmental, immunological, and then also there's smoking and obesity, which can increase your risk along with all these other genetics, environmental. Immunological would be like infections that played a role in causing rheumatoid arthritis, and then environmental factors would be like toxins that you inhale. And then rheumatoid arthritis is the second most common arthritis in the United States, and it affects about 1% of Americans. So let's talk about how this works. So the mechanism behind it. So there's an overreaction of the immune system, and the autoantibodies attack healthy joint and organ tissues within the body. So normal antibodies attack foreign viruses or bacteria, but autoantibodies are attacking healthy tissue, your own tissue. In the case of rheumatoid arthritis, it's specifically attacking the synovial joint. And the immune cells initiate a release of other destructive cells and chemicals. So the autoantibodies go into the joint, and this releases other chemicals and other destructive cells. And as you can see in this picture, so these are the immune response cells, leukocytes, T cells, all this initiates a cascade effect, and the T cells activate this to macrophages, to inflammation, bone erosion, all of that. So the cells initiate a response which causes the symptoms that people with rheumatoid arthritis have. And osteoclasts are initiated from this cascade, and they're recruited so highly that there's not enough osteoblasts, which are building bones. Osteoclasts are destroying bones. There's not enough to compensate for the bone loss, so that's why there is bone erosion and destruction. And then this causes a pannus, which is a thickened area of the joint, and then it also causes new blood vessels to form, which causes this inflammation and associates with the pain that people have who have rheumatoid arthritis. So normally the synovial fluid is present. There's articular cartilage at the end of the bones. The synovial membrane is not inflamed. It's normal. And in someone with rheumatoid arthritis, the synovial membrane is very swollen and inflamed. And this causes the joint pain, the tenderness, and the warmth that I talked about, and the symptoms, signs and symptoms. And then also there's a loss of cartilage at the ends of the bones, and this loss of cartilage causes friction and rubbing of the bones, which leads to pain, obviously. And then bone loss and erosion makes a person weaker and more unstable. So all of the signs and symptoms are associated together due to this inflammation and immune response. So how is it diagnosed? So your doctor will review the symptoms, all the symptoms that I talked about, and then they will use that to decide if an x-ray or blood tests are necessary. So in an x-ray, like you can see in this one, this is a progressive case of rheumatoid arthritis because the bones are already, and joints are already deforming. So clearly this person does have rheumatoid arthritis, but then also they can use a blood test, which a blood test will look for elevated proteins in the blood that indicate that there's an inflammatory and immune response happening. And then they can also look for rheumatoid factor, which is an autoantibody that indicates that that person has rheumatoid arthritis. And then the treatment. So the sooner that RA is diagnosed, the quicker treatments can be implemented to help slow the progression and control the inflammation. So the main goal of all of these treatments is to slow down joint damage, relieve pain, and reduce inflammation. So there's medications such as anti-inflammatory drugs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which relieves pain and can help reduce inflammation. There's steroids that are injection-based and they help with inflammation. Disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, which slow the progression, help prevent permanent joint damage. And they do this by suppressing the body's immune response and inflammatory response. And then biological agents, also called biological response modifiers, work with disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs to help slow and suppress the body's immune and inflammatory responses. And then there's physical therapy, which can help with joint pain, flexibility, and movement. They're really just making sure that your joints don't become stiffer and really just helping with that movement. And then they can also help you with learn new strategies if you do have loss of movement from the joints. They can help you with new strategies on how to still be doing your everyday tasks and be doing what you want to do, but in a way that helps you not have severe pain and maybe modify how you're doing those activities. And then the last resort would be surgery, and that helps repair damaged joints, restore movement, and then improve pain and function. There are several types of surgeries that can be performed to help with rheumatoid arthritis. There's a synoviovectomy, which removes the inflamed synovium, which is the synovial membrane. So it just removes it so that the inflammation and the thickening isn't so much. And then there's tendon repair, because the inflammation, the joint damage can cause tendons, put more stress on the tendons and cause them to be weaker and even rupture. So they can repair the tendon to help with pain. And then there's joint fusion, which you lose mobility with that, but you can, it stabilizes, realigns the joint, and it can help improve the pain that someone's having, but they will have a loss of movement. And then there's joint replacement, which removes the damaged part of the joint and replaces it with a prosthesis. So it's just removing the joint and putting an artificial one in. And then the prognosis. So with rheumatoid arthritis, there is an increased risk for developing osteoporosis, which is brittle, having brittle and fragile bones due to the loss of the tissue from the rheumatoid arthritis. There's Sjogren's disease syndrome. It has to do with dry eyes and dry mouth. There's an increased risk of infections due to rheumatoid arthritis being a autoimmune disease. A lot of the drugs and treatments to help eliminate the pain and the immune response suppress the immune system. So this can make you have an increased risk of infection. And then carpal tunnel syndrome, heart problems, lung disease, lymphoma, all of them are associated with the inflammation and the breakdown of the tissue. So like I said earlier, rheumatoid arthritis doesn't just affect the joints, it can affect other body systems as well, because it is damaging other organs and tissues. And then the earlier you diagnose and treat rheumatoid arthritis, the more crucial it is for the prevention of severe joint damage. So the earlier that you can detect it and treat it, the remission of symptoms is more likely to happen. So it's important to get ahead of it so that you don't have severe joint damage. So here are my sources. I hope that you were able to learn a little bit more about rheumatoid arthritis and how it affects the bones and joints.